Good evening and welcome to the Journey Home program. My name is Marcus Grodi, your host for this weekly program. EWTN gives me this wonderful privilege of introducing to you men and women who, because of their great love for Christ, have come home to the Catholic Church by the work of grace. But this is that open line first Monday, which allows me a little more freedom. And this is also the 11th anniversary program. We've been doing the Journey Home now for 11 years, and I wanted to have a very special guest for this anniversary program. In the past, I've had Mother Angelica when she was available. I think a week or so ago, you saw one of the Mother Angelica's programs from the 4th anniversary. It was a great program. It's good to see her again on the program. But tonight, we happen to have somebody visiting EWTN doing a series, and so it was a perfect opportunity to invite Father Brian Mullady here. Father is not a convert. He's a lifelong Catholic. We'll get to that in a little bit. But I remind you that this is your program. The Open Line program is specifically for allowing you more opportunities to call in or to write us emails with your questions. So you've probably seen lots of Father Mullady's programs at EWTN. Well, here he is live to answer whatever question you might have about the things that he has talked and written about. So if you'd like to call us, it's 1-800-221-9460. Outside North America, you can call it 205-271-2980, or you can send an email to journeyhome@EWTN.com. Father Mullady, welcome.
Thank
to the
you,
Journey
Marcus.
Home.
Thank
it
you.
Was providential that you happened to be here this week, because 11th anniversary, I wanted to make sure I had somebody special. And you were going to be here doing series, so there's all kinds of reasons I'm glad you're here, besides the fact that I belong to a Dominican parish, so it's great to have a Dominican on the program.
Great.
So welcome to the Journey Home. Maybe before I, even though you're not a convert, quote, to the church, I always ask on the Open Line program the guests to share a bit of their journey. Before you get there, though, what are you doing here at EWTN this week?
Well, this week I'm making another series, and this is on a book I actually wrote, which is a commentary on the document on the church in Vatican II. And it's an attempt to give a complete picture of what the teaching of the Vatican II really was concerning the nature of the church, and not what people who haven't read the documents or haven't really studied them and invoke this mythical spirit of Vatican II tell us that we actually should have thought, that the church should have taught. So it's kind of a difficult thing to do, because I have to use a text instead of just speaking extemporaneously. But I want to give a textual study, chapter by chapter, of the logical order, the method, and the teaching, which was really, according to at least the present Pope, one of Vatican II's primary contributions to our understanding of our faith.
Because John the 23rd's intent, we've got a little bust of him back there.
Oh, there he is.
Yes, was not to change our teaching, but maybe the way we express it.
Right, to make it more accessible to the modern world. And the odd thing is that, you know, Vatican I had meant to discuss 50 subjects, they used to call them schema, in 1870, but because of the political situation in Italy, the Council Fathers only got to discuss two. And so they tabled all the others, and things like the laity and the liturgy and all those things were things they meant to discuss in 1870. But then you had the Pope basically being imprisoned when the Italian state nationalized Rome. Then you had World War I. Then you had the Great Depression. Then you had World War II. And finally, around the 1950s, when everybody sort of recovered, they thought, well, we'd really like to continue this discussion. And so when John the 23rd opened the council, he had to canonically, formally close Vatican I, because nobody had ever done that. And he thought, they were thinking of calling Vatican II Vatican I-B. So instead he closed it, then opened this. But, you know, people think that all this was invented in the 60s, but it's all a continuity. And the subject of the church was the next interesting subject, because you had, in the early councils, you know, you had the Trinity and you had Christ, and then in the Middle Ages you had the sacraments, and in the Protestant Reformation you had grace and all that stuff. So in the logical order of the creed, the church was the next real thing to define. So they defined the infallibility of the Pope in 1870, but then they had to discuss everything else in the church, and they wanted to give a complete picture. So that's what I'm trying to.
All right, the title of the book?
The title of the book is Light of the Nations, which is an English translation of Lumen Gentium, the document of adjunct, because Christ is the light of the nations, and the church is, of course, the extension as a society of Jesus himself, the visible extension here on earth.
All right. Well, those of you, keep an eye on EWTN's schedule when this series will come up soon.
Right.
It's a great topic and very timely. Many of you may realize that we have a lot of neighbors who believe in Christ but don't believe that a church is necessary.
Right.
And that's a rampant idea in America. Mm-hmm. At least I know in America, I'm sure it's worldwide too. But well, Father, I always ask my guests on this program to at least spend a little bit of talk about your journey of faith.
Well, I was raised a Catholic. My mother was a convert. She was a Methodist. She converted when she was married. My father had kind of fallen away from the church during World War II and didn't particularly want her to convert, but she did because she was convinced of the faith, and she kind of brought him back. And interestingly enough, I was taught my prayers by my Methodist grandmother when I was a little boy, but then I had the sisters in grammar school for 6 or 7 years, and basically I had sort of a normal Catholic childhood of the 50s and the early 60s. And I decided to enter my order when I was in my second year in college. And I didn't really know any Dominicans when I entered. I entered mostly because I had a devotion to Thomas Aquinas. And I entered in 1966, and I don't know if you were around then. I've been around. But the world sort of fell off the end in 1968, both religiously and in other ways. And so I spent most of my seminary years, I went to Berkeley, or I call it Berserkly, to the seminary from 1967 to 1973.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah, it was a very interesting time.
Difficult times in the
whole 20th
century.
Yeah, I mean, the People's Park, I watched it from the roof of our House of Studies, the gassings and all that business. It was an interesting time. But the upheaval in the church, especially after Humanae Vitae, was tremendous. And I witnessed it all, and I participated in it all for a while. When I was a novice, I became sort of more and more radical, partially just because, you know, the mentality was you couldn't question anything. And so I decided to question quite a lot. And the first year or two I was in the seminary, I was insufferable because I was 20 years old, 21 years old, and I thought I knew everything. And I was articulate enough so that I could make my points. And the people of my order really couldn't stand me, a lot of them, because of that. But then the odd thing is that I sort of realized what was going on in the late 60s trip. And so I began to return to the faith. And the odd thing is that the person who actually was instrumental in this was an Episcopalian priest, because we took classes up at the Episcopalian Seminary, and I signed up for a course in St. Augustine. And the teacher was a professor named Dr. Massey Shepherd, who was a rather famous Anglican, more in the traditionalist Anglican side. He'd gone to the University of the South, and his favorite saint was Catherine of Siena. And the class consisted of reading The City of God from cover to cover, something I'd never really done. So my experience about reading The City of God was very much like Edith Stein's in reading The Life of St. Teresa. When I finished reading this book, I closed it up, and I said, you know, this is the truth, and all the stuff I've been spouting is just a bunch of garbage. Well, unfortunately, when I came to sort of this realization, everybody else was going the other direction, so we sort of passed like ships in the night, and I became much more orthodox, but they just, you know, authority, if the Pope said it, it was probably not true for them. And I think, unfortunately, in the religious orders, a lot of people began to get the idea that the order was more important than the papacy. So if the leadership told you something, or if you had decided something as a community, it didn't matter what the bishops or the Pope thought, that you would just do it. And that was especially true when it came to the celebration of Mass.
Yeah.
Some of the weird experiments that happened in that time. Because that was just around the time, remember, they really hadn't issued the new order of Mass, Paul VI, until 1969. So there were lots of weird experiments, some of which were subjected
to. I can't even imagine what it would have been like to be going to seminary. I had a friend of mine yeah. who's was in seminary at the same time period, and he said the entire time from when he entered seminary to he left seminary, there was no liturgy of the hours. I mean, it was a loose leaf thing, and
paperback breviaries.
Yeah, and mm-hmm. He essentially wasn't taught, because everybody figured, well, it's going to come together soon.
Right.
And so he missed that. He had to learn it on his own after he got out of seminary.
Right. Well, that's true. I mean, see, we went from the Latin office to nothing. And then they knew the office was going to change. So we had these paperback breviaries, paperback psalters. And then we got these dittoed sheets for years. And it was just a mess until like 74 or something. But of course, my order, oddly enough, we still are very tied to the Liturgy of the Hours. Yeah. So we used to go. It's just that some of the things, it's more like Mass, and especially when you were on vacation or someplace, you'd have these clown Masses and these crying Masses and these circus Masses. And, I mean, and people would make it up as they went along. I had a discussion with one of our big theologians who was my age. I remember it was going through Central Park, and he told me, well, if you're a good theologian, of course you can make up your own Eucharistic prayer. And I said, well, wait a minute, that's a prayer of the church. You can't make it up as you go along. He says, well, why not? I said, the bishops and the Pope have to approve it and all this. No, they don't. And then he said, well, St. Justin Martyr made up his own. And I said, yeah, but a lot of water's gone under the bridge since St. Justin Martyr. I mean, the Council of Nicaea, the Council of Trent. He says, well, who knows what councils were truly ecumenical? And I said, well, if we're not sure of that, we're not sure of much, are we? But, I mean, that was the mentality, yeah. You know. Yeah.
The other thing I can't imagine, and I certainly wasn't Catholic back then, is the experience of going through the altar turned around. That just seemed like, as I look back, yeah. It would have been a radical experience at the time.
Well, the odd thing is that when it happened, it was kind of nice because we'd all been kind of wanting to see it, you know.
Yeah, okay.
But then, of course, like everything, things have a good and a bad side.
Sure.
Then, after a couple of years, the sort of stage managing of the priest came about. Mm-hmm. So especially when the Latin was done away with, because the altars turned around in many places before they did away with Latin. You know, the Eucharistic prayer was still in Latin up until 67 or 68. And that's when the priest began to ad lib, and he became the center stage, and it became about his personality more than the ritual. And then, of course, the whole idea of ritual ended. Now, we were very fortunate. We had a sacraments teacher that had us read, oddly enough, books like Malinowski, Magic, Science, and Religion, which was a sociological study. And he tried to point out to us what the psychology of ritual really was, which is that you have these stylized actions which express things that are inexpressible in ordinary human language. And once you began to realize that it was a transcendent thing that you were expressing, and that the words and the canonized words are very important, then it became important to preserve what was written and not just kind of think that you could ad lib this and all that business. But the journey, I think, for me, and it's still an ongoing journey, of course, because everybody's conversion is ongoing. But the journey for me was, and it was a work of grace, I didn't do it. Everybody wants to know why I remained a Catholic through the whole thing. I mean, Father Fezzio and I were very close friends. I helped him found that institute that he founded. And I think a similar thing was true for him, because he was away for a while in some crazy movements. And it was Father de Lubach that brought him back. But it was a work of grace. It wasn't us. And I could tell you one or two moments or three moments that were really important in the whole idea. But why, you know, I was privileged to experience this thing, for example, with the City of God. And somebody else didn't have that? I really don't know. It certainly wasn't because of me.
That mystery of grace. Well, the folk that watch the Journey Home every week see that it's sometimes hard for the person to describe it was a person or a book or a place or an event or a crisis. It's kind of hard.
Right.
But yet in the midst of all that, we have this aha awakening. And one thing I'd thought about from your background and the things that you write about, and of course, I've grown to love Dominican teaching and spirituality is still,
yes.
I'm just a babe in it, but in our regular preaching in our Dominican parish. But it was a Dominican writer that helped me begin to understand Catholic spirituality. And it's sometimes hard when you come from a non-Catholic background.
Right.
Calvinist, which is where I was as a Presbyterian pastor, brought up Lutheran, congregations for all these different spiritualities. But Father Gary Legrand,
yes,
his ideas of the three ways of spiritual life, which weren't his ideas, but he made a statement in there that I wanted to put before you to talk to the audience about. And his statement was, which may not have been original with him, that in the ways of God, he who does not progress loses ground.
Right.
Talk about the importance of what he was getting at
okay. With
that concept.
I'll try. Grace, of course, in Catholic ideas is equality. It's equality of soul. It's not just God overlooking your sins, and it's not just God's aid. There is a way in which grace can be considered God's aid, which is what we call in scholastic terminology actual grace, which is where God enlightens your mind and strengthens your will to know the truth and do the good. But actual grace has as its purpose bringing a person to and maintaining what we would call sanctifying grace. And sanctifying grace is a true qualitative change in the very nature of what we are. And though, Protestants talk about having Christ in them and things like that, and that's certainly true, it's more than just a consciousness of Christ in you, it's a real change in you. So in other words, instead of just experiencing in justification the forgiveness of sins, you also experience the sanctification and renewal of the interior man. And what you're experiencing then is a plunging into the mystery of the depths of the Trinity. See, for Catholics, grace is a created thing in us, but it's a created thing by which we participate in an uncreated world. We participate so we can know as God knows and love as God loves and look at the world from a supernatural point of view. Now, obviously, this isn't something that we do ourselves, nor is it something that we can make happen ourselves. It's something that's a gift given to us, and then God aids and supports us in bringing us along by having this gift influence all of our thoughts and all of our actions. Sin is a tragedy because it precludes this influence from occurring in us, and it also makes the fire of this influence burn less brightly, and sometimes, if it's mortal sin, puts it out. And then if it's a mortal sin that's continuously affirmed, it makes you less disposed, when you do receive grace again, to having the freedom that grace should bring you. So just as the case with the physical health, for instance, you can grow in physical health or lose physical health. Just like health is a quality of body, so grace is a quality of soul, the health of the soul, in which we who are created in the image and likeness of God and made so that we can enter into colloquy, really, communion with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, can become more used to that way of living. And the three ages of the spiritual life are an attempt to explain, just as would be the case in a natural life, what spiritual infancy is like when you first are born into this life, and consciously born into it now, because by baptism you receive it. But I mean, to consciously experience it is a different thing, just like we receive life, but to consciously understand what that means and have it enter into ourselves, we have to grow in it. The second great way is like spiritual adolescence, and then the third great way is like spiritual maturity. And what this reflects is the Thomistic idea, which actually comes from Aristotle, of virtue. Virtue involves a qualitative change in the powers of your soul so that when you make free choices, you don't just accomplish good outside of you, you also accomplish interior integrity. Your powers become more integrated and qualities begin to exist in them, and that's in the intellect to know the truth, the will to carry it out in justice, but also that thing that we all struggle with, the passions. Qualities are introduced into the passions that enable them to easily be humanized and brought along to support what we know to be the truth and what we love to be the good. Now, free choices either encourage those qualities or discourage those qualities. And so there's no place where you can sit and say, okay, I've made it, I can't grow anymore, and I won't grow any less. Every single free choice is either a further qualitative aspect toward integrity or a qualitative aspect, if it's a sin, toward a lack of integrity. And if you're really bad off, you then begin to develop a quality where you prefer this lack of integrity, where you actually like it, not just struggling with it.
Yeah. Well, the context with all that, thank you, Father. I mean, what a way to summarize the spiritual life there. The context, if I remember right, that Father Greg Lagrange had made that quote, he had made the statement that, I don't think he said it's a shame, he may have said it was a sin, that the majority of Christians never progress beyond the first conversion. And basically, is to put it in practical, just common terms, how many Catholics never seem to progress past confirmation? I mean, they think they've arrived, and they don't take the effort or what it takes to progress. How do you help someone practically with what you've said, the work of grace and all that? Let's say that someone out there is wondering, am I progressing? How do I know if I'm progressing? What ought I to do to make sure I'm progressing in the spiritual life?
Okay. Well, first of all, people have to realize what grace is. And I give parish missions now a good bit of the year. My missions are all based on the doctrine of grace, and they're based on these three ages of the spiritual life. Most Catholics couldn't tell you what grace is. They don't have a clue. And many Catholics, as you know, are what we call cultural Catholics. I mean, they'd like to be baptized and they like to be confirmed, but they're not really sure why. And they don't look on it as affecting what happens in their life. And if they do become interested in a deeper religious experience, sometimes it's the idea that, well, if I could just have a vision, you know, or, you know, a little extraordinary experience, if God would only help me out that way. Or another thing is, I could be a saint if I didn't have to live with you. You know, it's all everybody else's fault that I don't grow in this. If I just had a different place, a different job, a different spouse, a different this, a different that. Well, all the spiritual authors in the book are clear about the fact that, you know, the way we allow grace to come about in our souls in a deeper sense is by what's called gospel living. Well, what's involved in gospel living? The very thing you were talking about, where you don't sit in the same resting place. You have to, first of all, admit what your personality has that is helpful to or unhelpful to experience in the life of God, and then how your practices relate to that. So the traditional answer is you begin to grow in grace by seeking to root out your faults and practice the virtues that are characteristic of your ordinary state in life. So there's nothing extraordinary about it, except in the sense that a person tries to make extraordinary love touch the ordinary actions that they do every day. Now, of course, to root out your faults, you first of all got to admit you've got them. And I don't know about you, but in the religious life, we joke about the fact, Father Emmerich made a series on this network, where he talked about the fact that our attitude is, there's nothing wrong with me, with me, with me, with me. It's all those people in the community I have to live with. It's your problem. I don't have a problem. Well, no, I mean, we all have concupiscence. We all have weakness from the original sin. We're all foolish of heart and slow to believe. And until we can admit our particular place in that, okay, you can't experience growth. The other thing is that there's all these wonderful positive opportunities with a married man, a single man, a priest, a sister, whatever, to make life more livable for others. And yet, how many people in marriage have their marriages fall apart because they're interested in stroking their own ego, and they really could care less about what their wife is going through, or they don't seek to see her point of view about the whole thing. And the same is true of the women. I mean, they don't seek to see the point of view of the men, and we do have a different point of view. Or religious life, etc.
All right. Well, you've planted a lot of seeds for our audience. We do have an email here. Let's start with this. See if we get this for the first break. It comes from Jim, and he says, Father Mullady and Marcus, I'm an evangelical Christian considering Catholicism. In watching EWTN, I constantly hear mention of, quote, Vatican II. Clearly, it was a very important event and seems to have changed Catholicism drastically. What were the major changes brought about by Vatican II? Now, and I can relate to Jim, because when Vatican II was happening, I was in my teen years, and
right.
I was oblivious to it happened because right. I wasn't a Catholic. Yeah.
Well, first of all, maybe I should begin answering this question by telling what one of our young seminarians said. We were having this discussion about the pre- and post-Vatican II church, And one of our seminarians about 5 years ago, who was maybe like 22 years old, he says, you know, I really don't have a clue what your people are even talking about. Because, and it's hard for, it kind of blows people my age's mind. This guy wasn't even born until after John Paul II was the Pope. The only Pope he ever knew in his life was John Paul II. So most people don't have a clue what we're talking about here. What I would say, if I had to give a thumbnail explanation of this, is that Vatican II was called by John the 23rd to produce a deeper spirituality in the church. Because some people had made the church a nasty bureaucracy, or with the codification of canon law, which was a good thing that happened, but you had so many lawyers and stuff produced by that, that oftentimes you got the idea that the church was just an earthly society that happened to have a religious purpose. And he wanted to, you know, make clear that this was a divine, supernatural society. Now, unfortunately, there are a lot of people that participated in this council that wanted to say something different. The bishops didn't say that, but all kinds of people ran with it afterwards. And in fact, Pope Benedict in the 1980s said that Vatican II had never really been implemented because people misinterpreted the whole thing, and they tried to sell people this bag of goods where the whole supernatural care of the church was basically ended. And the authority especially became greatly questioned. And then, you know, we hadn't changed the liturgy for 400 years, and there hadn't been significant changes in the liturgy for a long, long time. All of a sudden, when people began to change the Mass, even a little, people had the idea, well, all these things that we thought were chiseled in stone, everything's up for grabs. So from affirming it because we'd always done it, that became the worst argument of all for doing it. So you had all these experiments that people began to do, and they didn't believe that experiments could be bad too. You know, sometimes things explode when you make experiments. So in other words, people threw out the baby with the bathwater in this thing. And the Vatican II really didn't change the church drastically, but a lot of people interpreting it and trying to implement it tried to do that afterwards. Now, John Paul II wrote a lot of documents trying to point out that Vatican II hadn't changed the church drastically. Benedict is trying to recover a good bit of the continuity. You'll notice he permitted the celebration of the Mass in the former ritual, and he's called it the ordinary and extraordinary form. Now, he did that for a reason. He wanted to show the continuity between the things, that this wasn't some new world we recreated in 68.
Okay. Let's take a break. Got a bunch of emails waiting for us, Father, when we come back, so we'll see you in a little bit. Welcome back to The Journey Home. Our guest on this open line first Monday is Father Mullady, and we're glad to have you here.
Thank
Father.
Thank you.
I just have this sense as you're explaining that all the things you're explaining, there's so much more to it. You're just scratching the surface, and I have a feeling some of our emails are trying to delve in a little bit based on some of the things you've responded to. Let's take this next email. It comes from Brent in Louisiana. Marcus, my question tonight for you and your guests would be for suggestions on best practices in the faith. In other words, what prayers and activities do you feel allow you to continue to grow in your faith? Thank you, Brent, for that.
Well, of course, the Mass is the center of the whole thing. When it comes to devotional life, you know, people have a tendency to try to recommend their favorite devotion. There is no such thing. It's not, the beginning of the growth in prayer isn't a question of finding the right method or the right devotion. All methods can be helpful. All devotions can be helpful, depending on who the person is. Now, I enjoy the rosary very much And the rosary is a highly recommended aid to meditation, to mental prayer.
Very Dominican thing.
Yes, a very Dominican thing. But there are many people who don't relate that well to the rosary. So they might find something else. It's not a question of finding the right method. We Americans see, we are very practical people. We don't want involved explanations. Just tell me the quick, short, fast food way to get to a, you know, and bang them, I'll be an instant mystic. Well, there is no such thing. I mean, when St. Teresa began to write a book on prayer, she didn't talk about methods at all. She talked about growth in the virtues and rooting out the faults, because that's where the thing first begins. If a method will help you to do that, probably the most canonized method in the church that I admit I couldn't do because it's not my personality, but highly recommended and very helpful to many people are the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius. Mm-hmm. Now, I just can't do them. They're just not my personality. But some people who have that personality can be quite helpful. But I would encourage the person who wrote that to realize that apart from the Mass and the sacraments, it's not a matter of finding the instant way to kind of experience communion with God, because there isn't one. It's like saying, well, what's the instant way to have the ideal marriage? You know, and especially if I can just do this method, I want to think about my spouse, fight, make up, cook meals, do all that stuff. Well, you have to do all that stuff. And you have to do all that stuff on a daily basis. You have to do all that stuff by personal interest in the other. If there's a method that will help you to be personally interested in the other, fine. But if not, then concentrate on gospel living. That's the real issue.
Another example, especially those that are in business and are familiar with all the different time management programs that are out there. I mean, there's hundreds and hundreds of books on techniques for time management. And what happens is somebody finds one that really works for them, and it works so good for them, they put it into a book.
They force it in everybody else.
And then few people find that it works for them. A few do. And it's just, again, we are so different, but you know, the issue of getting rid of distractions and, you know, looking ways to experience silence with God, I mean, there's some basic things that probably work all across the board, right? I mean, I think probably one of the hardest things seems to me for people with struggles with prayer is all the distractions that come in. And they're looking for a technique to try to cut those out, but there's no technique that...
No. Well, and distractions are normal. Yeah. The time when distractions in prayer are bad is if you want to be distracted. If you do stuff to distract yourself, like you go in and sit and say, well, okay, I'm going to pray, but I'm going to read the New York Times while I'm doing that. Okay, well, that's something you produced yourself. But you may as well try to stop heaven and earth from moving than your imagination. You can't will your imagination away. Mm-hmm. What happens is that when you become aware that you're having a distraction, then if you have a method like the rosary or you're reading a spiritual book or something like that, then you can go back to it. But like if you're reading a spiritual book, the purpose isn't to get through this like you do when you study something to pass a test. It's to find some pleasant truth, the Bible or some spiritual book, that helps you to experience a love reaction for Christ. That's all.
Yep.
And then you rest in that for the time it lasts, whatever time it may be. And then when you become aware that you're experiencing a distraction again, or you can't focus or whatever, then you'd use and whatever help you can to help you to do that again. But I emphasize very much still that what happens outside the time, whatever it is you spend in prayer, is as important as what you do in that time. One of the reasons the rosary is so helpful is because you have an automatic method that gives you something that you can do with your hands and say with your lips. It lasts about 15 minutes, and for the ordinary layperson, you can do it anywhere. Mm-hmm. So it's one of the, and of course it's connected to Our Lady and also to Scripture, because it has the mysteries of our Lord's life. So,
all right, yeah. Thank you, Father. Let's take our first caller, Bernard from Florida. Hello, what's your question for us tonight?
Oh, yes. Thank you, Marcus.
Yep.
I've often been picked up on making judgments, and I often complain that it's nothing but an opinion. Could Father tell us what the difference is between making a judgment and offering an opinion?
Thank you, Bernard.
Well, I don't know what the questioner is asking about the judgment, how that relates to our topic. If he's speaking about the verse in Scripture, judge not lest you be judged. All right. Well, what Christ is talking about there isn't making judgments about the truth, because we do that all the time. Nor is he talking about people who are experienced, like who had a long experience in things, being able to make judgments about when, for example, they're being hoodwinked by somebody or something like that. What he's talking about is rash judgment. And rash judgment are when a person makes a judgment from little evidence or from a prejudice. And St. Thomas, for example, has a question where he asks in the Summa, if doubt should always be interpreted for the best when you're doubtful about a person's intentions or their character. And he says, yes, and the reason is because if I'm mistaken about doubting things for the worse, then I commit an injustice toward the other person because I've judged them guilty of something that they're not guilty of. But if I'm mistaken in judging things for the best, the only person I've hurt is myself, which is not injustice. You know, you can't be unjust to yourself. And so I may suffer because I was fooled or I lose something, but I don't experience a loss of soul. It's related to the famous statement of Socrates, it's better to suffer injustice than to do injustice. Because in suffering injustice, you're only harmed physically or emotionally, but if you do injustice, you can lose your soul, especially if it's deep enough and bad enough.
Well, I imagine also what he's getting at then is why people hesitate to talk about religion and politics.
Oh, that could be.
Because to express your opinion about it, it's hard to keep that cold mm-hmm. without it feeling like I'm making a judgment on your opinion.
Right.
I'm just expressing my idea, and it's hard to keep that from becoming personal.
Right.
How do you keep it? And that's hard. I mean,
yes.
That's why, again, people don't talk about religion and politics very often.
Right.
But how do we defend our faith? It's not just an opinion, nor am I making a judgment on someone. I'm passing along mm-hmm. what the church has said. This is a spirit-led fullness of my faith.
Well, the trouble is when it comes to people, they're very complicated. When it comes to ideas, you can certainly make judgments. With people, you're dealing with many unknown factors, so you have to take that into consideration.
All right. Yeah. I think we have another email awaiting us here. Let's see which one the producer wants to throw up on the screen for us to look at. Okay, this is a T.S. Eliot question.
Oh.
Bill from Wisconsin. T.S. Eliot intimated in his verse that the last sin to conquer is that of spiritual pride. How does the person seeking to advance ever further in his spiritual development wrestle with this problem? And to what extent does further spiritual growth give rise to the temptation of pride in one's spiritual development? Thank you, Bill.
Okay. Well, I think the line actually comes from Murder in the Cathedral. And I know about this because my religious name, which I don't use much except in official documents anymore, is Thomas Becket. Mm-hmm. But the line is actually, the last temptation is the final treason to do the right thing for the wrong reason. Mm-hmm. And what T.S. Eliot was trying to say there, because it was about the martyrdom of Thomas Becket, was that Becket might be tempted to seek this for his own glory, in other words, for his own egotism, not because he was trying to defend the rights of the church. Well, St. Augustine said in the rule that the Dominicans follow that pride, unlike other sins, even enters in and corrupts good works. The temptation is always to look at yourself instead of what you're doing. Like if you're a great preacher, you know, you stand up there and all the congregation is sitting in front of you and you're making an especially important point and you see all these people and some of them are moved and all of a sudden you think, aren't I great? And then you have to say, yeah, look what you did last night, or look what you did yesterday. Yeah, you're great, all right. You know, something like that. St. Bernard once said that he began a sermon and he was tempted to pride during it. And he said, get behind me, Satan. I didn't begin because of you, and I'm not going to end because of you. Things like that. I mean, yeah, pride is, you know, the worst of the sins. It's the most spiritual of the sins. It's the sin of the Pharisees, really. And the Lord was pretty merciful on the tax collectors, sinners, and prostitutes, but he was merciless toward the Pharisees. And one of the reasons was because they were very good men, but the trouble is they had a tendency to think they could do it all on their own. So as you're growing in the spiritual life, you have to remember that everything you've received is a gift. You didn't do all this. You're just sort of going along, so to speak. And then if God brought this forth, if he's, you know, using you as an instrument, he's doing most of the stuff. And if you're really honest about it when it ends, you can say, well, you know, people sometimes congratulate me. And I said, well, you know, it wasn't really me. I mean, I was just there. I mean, I wouldn't have done some of these things on my own. There was someone who was helping me and moving me to do this. And I can't explain it. There's no other way to explain it.
Isn't that a bit of Thomas himself was fighting against in the end, when he just set the whole thing aside and said it was just a bunch of straw.
Oh, well, people make a lot of that. I think what St. Thomas was just trying to express there is, you know, we say many things and words fall short in the end, but you know, if you look at all the books he wrote, especially in the time when there was no typing or anything, I mean, the corpus is like 7 volumes of triple columns with print this big that are 1,000 pages long. So amazing. He thought it was worthwhile to do, but no one knows exactly what that was all about. Some people think it was a stroke. Some people think it was a mystical experience. Mm. It's very mysterious, the whole thing. He did write and dictate one or two things afterwards, but not much. And then he died.
Let's take our next caller, Jean from New York. Hello, what's your question?
Yes. Father, I would like to know, what is redemptive suffering? I keep hearing about it, and someone once told me, because I'm having a problem right now, that I'm going through redemptive suffering. What does this mean?
Thank you, Jean.
Well, first of all, that's the suffering of our Lord, right? So it's where our Lord surrenders certain things, like his physical body, and many of the things in his passions, in order to atone for the original sin. In other words, our Lord had to suffer some of the punishments for the original sin in order to make up for Adam and Eve's unloving disobedience. And he had to show loving disobedience in doing that. So he couldn't suffer the punishments for the original sin that might have to do with him morally vacillating in his loving obedience, but he suffered from physical punishments. Now, what someone might mean by that is that, you know, we have people who are very innocent who suffer horrible deaths. I had a sister friend who died of bone cancer, from which she suffered for 3 years. She was a very fine person. But to show you her attitude toward this, and spiritual people are like this, I think, see, ordinary people looking at things from a supernatural point of view, to understand Sister's comment about this, you have to realize she lived in a religious order that had basically given up the whole religious life, and she retained the old habit till the day she died. But she was always very loyal to her community. She never criticized them. Well, she suffered from bone cancer for 3 years. She had an operation where she had her arm replaced, her hip replaced, just so she could die, but she never complained. The people in her rest home said, you know, we never had a patient that it was such a pleasure to serve. She's always joyful. She never talks about herself. So just before she died, I was in her room, and she grimaced as she moved. So I said, okay, come on, come clean. You're suffering an excruciating agony, right? This is all just an act put on for the group. And she smiled at me, and she said, oh, heck. Compared to the 50 years of mental anguish I've suffered in the convent, dying of bone cancer is a walk in the park. She said, physical pain means nothing to me compared to the mental anguish I've suffered in the convent. Now, a person can offer their physical sufferings, as our Lord did, for the sake of someone who isn't willing to suffer, who isn't willing to experience conversion, and vicariously do this. Like we think of Maria Goretti, who, you know, her forgiveness forgave her attacker and prayed that her suffering might be a means by which he would be brought to conversion, and he was. It's possible for us to merit the first grace for another person, not, of course, by strict equality, because I know people think, the Catholics think we do this by strict equality, but by our proportionate participation in a love relationship with Christ. It's possible, with related to Christ, to pray to our Lord. And there's an interesting statement St. Thomas makes again in the Summa, where he says, by a kind of proportionate equality, if we do the will of God and lovingly, and we have a loving exchange of hearts with him, God will want to do man's will in certain things. And people have used, God has used persons' forgiveness of their acts or their suffering as a means to bring about the conversion of another, provided, of course, the other is open to it at all.
It's not quite as used since I've become a Catholic, but the old phrase, offer it up.
Right.
Is really what you're talking about. We don't use it quite as much today as it was used in the past, but really this is the idea of rather than focusing on why me, my we, is offering it up.
Right.
And so that can be used in some meritorious way for the right. good of others.
Well, and for yourself, too. I mean, many of us, though we love God and we've done good things and we hope to go to heaven, we have lots of things in our personalities that have warred against that, and that's what purgatory is for. But, of course, as you know, you can experience your purgation on earth.
No.
So by actively offering your suffering, for even for yourself. So a person might mean by that, you know, I'm making up for what I've done to other people, and I hope that it will make my love so intense that I won't ever have to suffer after I die.
For those of you who want to study more about that, this kind of touches on Colossians 1:24. You know, he rejoices it. Paul rejoices in his suffering,
right?
Because he's completing what is lacking. But John Paul's wonderful encyclical on that very topic. I always forget the Latin term, but he has it. It's on suffering. Salvadoris. I forget how it goes.
Father. Oh, Salvifici Doloris.
Yes. Excellent encyclical. Right. If you want to study more about that, I'm sure you can get that from EWTN's website. But it's a wonderful Bible study, actually, on Colossians 1:24. Let's take our next email. It comes from Angela from Wisconsin. Dear Father and Marcus, I love the show and would like to ask Father a question. Can you ever know for certain whether we are in a state of grace?
Oh, I'm glad you asked that. Yes, I do know the answer to this question. Because grace is a supernaturally induced state, only God actually knows whether we're in the state of grace or not. Now, we have what's called a relative certainty that we're in the state of grace. In other words, if we're not conscious of having committed a mortal sin, and we're doing all that, you know, our faith asks of us, we have a relative certainty we're in the state of grace. So when people ask you, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you saved? Well, we can't really say yes exactly. We can say, well, I hope to be. I'm on my way to be. I know Christ has given me the grace to be. But until I actually die, I'm not really absolutely certain. All right. Now, sometimes God does enlighten people by personal private revelation with the fact that they're in the state of grace so that they can undergo some kind of suffering, right? Like martyrdom, for instance. But unless that happens, all we can say is, well, with Joan of Arc. This is a famous example. Joan of Arc's judges, you know, because she was an unlettered girl when they were trying her, these doctors of theology tried to trip her up. So they asked her directly, Joan, are you in the state of grace? Because if she said yes, they would have burned her as a heretic because you can't know you're in the state of grace. And if she, with absolute certainty, and if she'd said no, they would have burned her as a witch because all the things she did were obviously by diabolical inspiration. So this is actually used in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Joan of Arc said, if I'm not, may God put me there, and if I am, may God keep me there, thus confounding her judges. But I don't think, I wouldn't tell a scrupulous person this because they go nuts, you know, over this. Yeah, we have a relative certainty we're in the state of grace. If we're trying to love God, we're not conscious of a mortal sin, and we're doing the best we can. So not to worry about it. Don't worry about where you're at or something like that. Worry about the fact that you love Christ and you're trying to make life more livable for others and correspond to whatever the gifts are that you have been given.
There's a wonderful French writer from a couple hundred years ago named Father Gros, and he was talking about that, and I think you can get this on EWTN's website also, one of his books. But at the time, he was being critical of the non-Catholic theologians who their only focus was on salvation. Everything was on salvation. And his argument was saying that when you examine their thinking, it was all very self-focused, but my salvation. And he says really the first step is you be your focus on the glory of God. That's what our focus is, the glory of God. And then second of all, is our holiness as we seek to imitate Him. And salvation, we trust to Him.
Well, of course, this anguish over the whole thing is very reflective in Luther's life, you know. As you remember, when he was a Catholic, he just anguished and anguished and anguished over everything. I feel sorry for his poor old confessor, the Augustinian Stolpitz, because I think he goes to confess for 2 hours every day. And, you know, I mean, that was certainly a big exaggeration. I mean, if I'd been his spiritual director, I would have kicked him out and told him to stop worrying
about it. But it points to the example that, in some sense, the whole Reformation was because of a man who has had poor formation or bad catechesis or whatever it was.
A very tormented soul, And the only way he could free himself from the torment was, in some sense, to try to free himself from the whole ball of wax, I guess. But this anguish and anguish he experienced when he was a Catholic, remember when he said his first Mass, he stopped for like 30 minutes because the canon begins with Te Igitur Clementissime Pater, to you we come, most clement Father, and he couldn't see how such a worm as a creature could address the Creator in that way. I mean, but I'm sure, I know in Protestant prayers they do address the Creator, so I mean, you know.
Makes me think of another great book called The Spirit and Forms of Protestant by Father Bouyer. I think EWTN offers that, so because it deals with that issue. Yeah. Luther was good so far that he went too far. You know, that takes it too far.
Very scrupulous.
And exactly. Let's take our next caller, Stephen from Ohio. Hello, what's your question?
Hi, Marcus. Good evening.
Yep.
Great show as always. I have a question for Father. I'm a lifelong Catholic, and several years ago had a dramatic reconversion experience, which would take way too long to explain here tonight, but I have a question that spins off of that. During a several-year period where I felt this very strong reconversion to the Church, I took several trips down to the Abbey at Gethsemane in Kentucky, and there I was exposed to the Liturgy of the Hours for the first time in my life. Even as a lifelong Catholic with clergy and priests and religious in my family tree, had never been exposed to it. In any event, recently I've begun praying the office. I don't do it all the time because I don't have a monk's hours, but I do recite it. And I'm curious, Father, to what degree do Liturgy of the Hours play a part in your personal spirituality today, and how do you see it possibly playing a part in those lay people?
Thank you, Stephen. I know a lot of people that try the Divine Office and it just doesn't click with them. You know,
right. Yep. Well, the Divine Office comes from the temple. I mean, it has to do with the hours of prayer that were practiced in the temple. And it's in our frame of reference, this is an extension of the celebration of the Eucharist. Mm-hmm. And it also comes from one of the verses in the Psalms, seven times a day I praise you, O Lord. So when the monks did that, they tended to extend this celebration of the Eucharist using the Psalms, the temple liturgy, and all that business, according to the hours of the day, so that the day would be sanctified. So they used to rise at midnight and start then. Then there'd be 3, 6, 9, etc. Hmm. All right. Now, obviously, this is a very beautiful way to pray, and it's a very deep way to pray. And since it has its origin in the temple liturgy, it's also a very scriptural way to pray. For many years, it was closed to a great number of the laity because it was always prayed in Latin, and the laity did not, many of them, have an experience of Latin, though it was common in many parishes for people to at least attend the hour of Vespers on Sundays in parish churches. And many of them knew that particular office, you know, from memory. In more recent years, the Divine Office has been changed a little after Vatican II, so the way the Psalms and the readings and things are interspersed around it would perhaps be a little more accessible. The Dominican Order is very committed to the choral recitation of the Divine Office, like the monks. And we enjoy it, and we do it as best we can, even in our parishes with the laity. And we encourage them to become close to it. The trouble is, it is a very difficult prayer to get into, and the rosary has 150, used to anyway, have 150 beads, because it was the Psalter, it was called Our Lady's Psalter, and it was considered to be the office for the laity. In fact, in my order, the brothers, many of whom didn't know Latin, when we'd be chanting the Psalms, they'd be saying the rosary, see, that was their thing to do. But I would encourage you, if you do say the office, to continue doing it, to become deeply involved in it, and especially to read the readings for the Office of Readings, because they're very deep, and the responses after them help you to see their connection to Christian mysteries. Like when you're dealing with, what is it, Jabin and Sisera and the tent pegs and all these people killing each other in the Old Testament. Sometimes it's difficult to see just exactly how that relates to Christianity, but oddly enough, the responsory after it relates it to the Gospels or to St. Paul or something like that.
Thank you, Father. Hey, could I ask you as we close the program to say a blessing for us?
All right. May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever. Amen.
All right. Thank you, Father.
Thank you for having me.
Wonderful to have you here. And also, thank you for doing the series here on the Church. Look forward to that.
Well, we try our best. Hopefully we'll get it done. So,
and the name of that book again, just in case someone's out there wondering.
Oh, my book?
Yes.
It's called Light of the Nations.
There we go, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, because a fine subject. I know a lot of viewers come from traditions where the church isn't as important, and I think it's important to hear the Catholic perspective on the necessity of the church.
Yes.
So thank you very much
for
all that you've shared with us. Thank you for joining us on this episode of The Journey Home. I do pray that this was an encouragement to you to keep progressing in the spiritual life. We've done The Journey Home for 11 years. I hope these presentations have been encouragement to grow in grace. God bless you. See you again next week.